Bonjour. Nous avons vu précédemment l'impact de l'intelligence artificielle sur, bien entendu, des cas d'usage, sur les modèles économiques, sur les compétences et sur les métiers. Maintenant, voyons plus grand. Essayons de comprendre l'impact de l'IA sur le travail. Premier impact, l'intelligence artificielle va transformer nos habitudes. C'est sur ce thème que nous travaillons au sein du Learning Lab Human Change et nous avons rencontré nos homologues à la Singularity University à San Francisco. Cette université virtuelle travaille sur les nouvelles technologies d'IA et travaille surtout sur une réflexion par rapport au futur du travail. Gary Bowles nous explique les trois briques que le manager doit intégrer dans ce nouveau rapport au travail. Tout d'abord, l'adaptation. Le manager doit pouvoir changer de rôle, changer de compétences et être adaptable par rapport aux projets sur lesquels, eh bien, il doit s'engager dans une entreprise. Deuxième brique, c'est ce qu'on appelle l'agency. L'agency, c'est quoi? C'est non plus le fait de réaliser une tâche par rapport à une fiche de poste, par exemple, mais prendre ses compétences et les mettre au service de l'entreprise et dire, sur ce projet, oui, j'ai la compétence et je peux apporter une valeur ajoutée. Être dans une définition des problèmes et dans une opportunité à proposer ses compétences. Et la troisième brique est celle de l'agilité. Demain, nous dit Gary, eh bien, les collaborateurs devront travailler avec des profils transdisciplinaires en mode agile et collaboratif. Écoutons cette très intéressante interview. Hello Gary, thank you so much because we are here in San Francisco and you are the founder of a chair of the Future of Work of the Singularity University.
Correct.
So thank you so much because it's a real honor to be here and to discuss with you. Can you speak about the Singularity University? What is it?
So Singularity is about a 10-year-old institution based in Mountain View, California. It was founded by Ray Kurzweil and Peter Diamandis, who were both visionaries who saw that people were having challenges in trying to understand the impact of what they called exponential technologies. Technologies ranging from artificial intelligence to the future of energy that are moving at an increasingly rapid pace. And so Singularity is a set of courses and educational experiences and resources that are designed to help people to understand these exponential changes and then hopefully to be able to use that understanding to be able to create an abundant future.
And what is the way of thinking the future of work and the future of learning for the Singularity perspective?
So the typical challenge that we have when we talk about the future of work and the future of learning is that a lot of the dialogue nowadays is about the impact of robots and software on jobs and that sort of thing. And instead I think we'd like people to really be focusing on the understanding of what work is and how humans use their energies to be able to solve problems. So if we're all problem solvers and what we're doing when we're paid by an employer or we're trying to be able to do meaningful work, the challenge that we have is continuing to find the kinds of problems that we like to solve, that we're most optimized to being able to solve, and the ones that people want to be able to compensate us for. And so typically, when we talked about the future of work and what it's going to look like, you know, down the road, it's probably going to be a lot more where individuals in the past who needed to get a big chunk of education at the beginning of their lives or chose particular fields that they were going to be in for a long period of time, we're going to find that the rapid pace of change, the impact of automation and globalization, is going to probably change a lot of those dynamics so that we all have to become much more lifelong learners. We have to have greater agency in the work that we do. We're going to probably have to create work as well as find work, and we're going to have to continually float and adapt to the new kinds of problems that we can solve.
Yes, we have a very interesting discussion, and I remember that your third concept was the three blocks, and you speak about agency, you speak about adaptation, and you speak about agility.
Right.
Is it the skills for the future for a manager?
So yes, these are absolutely critical for all workers and especially for managers. So let me just describe these. So when we talk about agency, what we mean is your ability to get off the dime and do something. So in any situation, if you in the past you thought that work was just going to come to you, that's going to be rarer, more and more rare. And instead, you have to have agency. You have to be somebody who feels like you're empowered to go do your work. The second is that you need to be adaptable, because as I mentioned, the pace of change is only going to increase. And so we're all going to have to be able to deal with those changes. And work that used to be pretty static in the past is probably going to be much more rapidly changing in the future. And then the third is agility. If you see new opportunities, you're going to have to move quickly to be able to take advantage of those opportunities. That means being able to do what we call just-in-time learning, gathering the information you need to be able to perform those particular tasks, and trying to be as agile as possible in not just finding work opportunities, but in creating them.
Thank you so much, Gary. It was a real pleasure to discuss with you, and thank you for your insights.
No, great. Thank you.
Ce n'est pas facile d'endosser de nouvelles attitudes lorsqu'on a été programmé. Mais la bonne nouvelle, c'est que les neurosciences nous expliquent que l'on peut reprogrammer le cerveau humain. C'est ce que nous avons découvert avec Vivian Ming, professeure à Berkeley, qui, dans son interview, à partir d'une recherche réalisée sur une population très pauvre qui a réussi à être reprogrammée dans sa prise de décision, eh bien, elle nous explique qu'il y a énormément d'espoir pour reprogrammer les comportements humains et donc les structurer sur de nouveaux modèles. Son interview est extrêmement intéressante.
Hello Vivian, thank you very much to have this interview. We are in Berkeley University and you are a scientist, a neuroscientist here. So you have great research about survey and about how we can find to have perhaps a better life. Can you speak about your research?
Absolutely. My work looks at what really predicts how we make better people, how people can have better long-term life outcomes in terms of wealth, in terms of happiness, health outcomes, looking at little kids and families, looking at workers inside of companies. I have never found a problem that I wasn't interested in trying to figure out what it was that drove the best possible outcomes for the people involved.
So you have found constructs that are very important in the life. What are these constructs?
So we wrote a paper about this. We call them meta-learning constructs, and there are quite a few of them. What we did was we looked at these massive data sets, 122 million people, and we looked to see what actually predicted the best employees, the best work, the best long-term career outcomes. And what we found over and over again, that it wasn't grades, it wasn't the university you went to, it wasn't the specific skills in terms of whether you knew how to program or you knew how to sell. None of that was really meaningfully predictive. Sometimes really shockingly so. The best schools in the world were only a little bit of an added benefit. What we found was that it was these meta-learning qualities. It was things like general cognitive ability, your ability, your attention, your memory, your language skills, metacognition, your ability to self-assess, to think strategically, plan for the future, social skills, perspective taking, even low-level social skills, my ability to recognize your facial expressions, my ability to understand the idea that someone else has a mind of their own, creativity, lateral thinking, divergent thinking, creativity itself, fascinating construct. It applies across the board to everyone, not just people working in creative domains, everyone. And social skills. Oh, sorry, I already mentioned, social skills. That's fascinating also. I mean, just as predictive for engineers as it is for salespeople. The last one is emotional intelligence. So, and that's one of the most fascinating. But what we see is if I was given a random group of people, whether they were 4 years old or 40 years old, whether they came from poor backgrounds or wealthy backgrounds, if I knew these qualities about them, I could give you strong predictions about the directions of their life.
And you speak about the will, the power of the will. What does it mean?
So I mentioned this idea of emotional intelligence and its strong predictive quality. And some of the specifics, so those are just really broad, big ways of talking about it. Some of the specifics of emotional intelligence, endogenous motivation, purpose, some very geeky language, belief-based utility. It turns out if you can go to someone and change their belief that their hard work will pay off in their life, you can change everything about them. And that is a powerful discovery, both that it is possible to change these things, so that if I were a boss, a manager, or a teacher, or a parent, that the people in my life, I could make better by helping them improve their motivation, improve their belief that their hard work will pay off, but also that it has these profound impacts that when you rob someone of the power of these beliefs, you really are robbing them of their future. That we see again and again that people with these strong beliefs, this will, as you put it, have dramatically different outcomes. It's not about whether they knew how to program or whether they knew how to do financial accounting. It is ultimately about whether they believed in what they were doing.
Thank you for this tip. The power of beliefs is crucial. And to conclude, what is your opinion, the difference between the artificial intelligence and the augmented intelligence? What kind of behavior can we have if we want to be adapted to the world?
Yeah, so I think we have a very big choice in front of us. As artificial intelligence, not a new idea, but a transformative one in the world today, as it becomes a technology that sort of pervades everyday life, that we have this choice. Do we use it to substitute for what we can already do? Or do we use it to make us better? On the one hand, it could be that we hire less qualified people to do the same jobs that we used to only send people to university to train for, because now the AI will do it for us, and I just don't need an expensive, highly qualified person. On the other hand, we imagine what it is such a creative person could do if at their fingertips they had the power of the most powerful machine intelligence. And we call that augmented intelligence, the best merging of what machine and natural human intelligence could accomplish. And it's a big, profound question, because when you start substituting for people, when you do what they can do themselves, I believe that you rob people of who they are in a pretty fundamental way. When, on the other hand, we talk about augmentation, we're talking about transforming people and taking them to a completely new place. And for me, that boils down to a very simple story that isn't just about AI. And that story is, perhaps most simply put, in the idea that technology should always challenge us. We shouldn't just be better when we're using technology. We should be better than where we started when we turn it off.
Thank you very much, Viviane. Thank you for this great interview. And we will be very pleased to read your book. I think next year we can have a book. Do you know the title, perhaps?
I got a couple of books coming out, and one is How to Robot-Proof Your Kids, and the other is The Tax on Being Different.
So thank you so much, and we are very eager to read them. Thank you.
Thank you.
Vous l'avez bien compris, l'intelligence artificielle est à la fois une source de questionnement et d'opportunité. Le rapport au travail sera modifié avec l'IA, et ce MOOC était là pour vous donner des pistes et pour vous rassurer. À bientôt!